used to talk in English in Italy, okay? So, you know, sometimes when I make sessions in Italy, I always say, okay, I can talk Italian. No, not this time, okay. Anyway, so my name is Paolo Salvatori. I'm a principal program manager in the Windows Azure Customer Advisory Team. So I have been working in Microsoft since 1997, 16 years. So a lot of time, probably too much. And I spend most of this time in Microsoft services doing projects. And in 2007, I joined the Bistro Rangers. And I started to fly around Europe making architecture and design reviews. But then somebody came to us in 2011 and said, OK, you have done Bistro so far. OK, now from now on, forget about Bistro. There is just one thing. The cloud, Windows Azure, okay? So, and the same happened to the SQL guys, SQL Server guys. But of course, I'm joking, but not so much, okay? So, let me say that I'm allowed to continue to do biztalk, but only in a specific context, hybrid solution. So, and that's what we are going to see today. So, I have a lot of demos and presentations, but today, fortunately, we had Steve to make an introduction about hybrid solutions, so I'm not going to repeat, you know, the things that Steve said about how to integrate Service Bus with biztalk server, biztalk services. We'll see some demos in this regard, but I want to focus more my attention on mobile services and how to basically create applications to expose corporate assets. Like, I don't know, LOB applications, repositories, and services to, let's say, mobile applications. Okay, we'll see a lot of solutions throughout the presentation. Honestly, I don't think I will have the time to give you the details of all of the solutions, but as you will see, everything is explained in excrucial details on my blog and on a MSDN code gallery. So you can go here and you can, yes, it's quite, and you could go here and look at all the steps necessary to provision the solution, to set up the solution, explanation of the code, and so forth. Okay, so if you miss something from a technical standpoint, I don't think it's a big deal. Because again, you can go here and read the entire story. So for me, it's more important you understand the scenario and how to assemble the various technologies to create the final solution, okay? So let's start from the objectives. It's always a good thing to start from the objectives, okay? So we are going to see today a very small introduction to mobile services, really, really small introduction, because mobile services are very rich in terms of feature and functionality, so it would require an entire, I don't know, hours and hours to explain all the features in details, okay? And then in the second part, we'll look at some real demos, okay? And so I really hope that this is going to, you know, to light some some ideas, to spark some ideas in your brain, okay? So why is mobile so important? Is it really necessary to say why is so important today? I don't really think so, okay? So as you know, it's, you know, if you look at this diagram, it's quite clear that over here, you know, the people watching TV or navigating or browsing the internet remain pretty much stable, but you know, mobile applications are dramatically increasing. Okay, but and you know better than me that also the enterprise is really interested in creating applications to expose their services to employees with on mobile devices. Okay, so. So the application, what are the challenges in this space? As I said, the enterprise want to create internal application for their employees, but they want to reuse the same platform they use to develop applications for, let's say, users and customers, okay? And they don't want to spend too much time developing these. So they want to have a very quick way to create, let's say, a RESTful a layer of RESTful services in front of their corporate assets. When I say corporate assets, once again, I mean systems running on the corporate network, like LOB systems, CRM, ERP systems, repositories, any kind of service, okay? So Windows Azure Mobile Services provide the ability to create, in a very easy way, this kind of layer of RESTful service, and they are also fully integrated, as you will see, with SQL Azure. This doesn't mean that you need to necessarily use SQL Azure as a database. You can also, for example, use table storage. I created an article and a solution on SDN that explain how to do that. Or again, you can access corporate services, as you will see, through biztalk services and the service bus. So the key scenarios for mobile services are make your application, let me say, sexy and dynamic using push notifications, so live tiles and toast notifications. I'm not just talking of Windows Mobile, of course, I'm talking of iOS, so iPhone, Android, all the most important, platform for mobile applications, okay, including Windows Store apps. As you will see, mobile services also support HTML5. So you can also make a dynamic site in HTML5 and leverage mobile services. Rapid development, once again, it's very important that you are, you know, up and running in a short time. So as you will see, mobile service is very easy. And make your application social. This is a very important aspect because, as you know, it's users don't really want to, especially when making a consumer application more than an enterprise application, they don't want to create yet another, you know, user, or they want to use their own credentials on Facebook, on Twitter, on Google, or Live ID. Okay, and as you will see, mobile service provides this kind of integration with the most important identity providers and social networks. So, and this kind of integration is made through an OAuth or OAuth. It depends if you talk with Americans or English, authentication flow. So this is the architecture in a nutshell. So as you can see on the left-hand side, we have the connected applications. So Windows Store application, iOS, Android, Windows Phone 8, but recently also 7.5, and HTML5 plus JavaScript, okay? For what regards data, as you will see, when you create a mobile service, you have the chance to create also a SQL Azure database or to select an existing one, okay? And the two are quite integrated, as you will see. For what regards user authentication, you can rely on Facebook, Twitter, Microsoft, and Google. You can configure your mobile service to use these identity providers. And mobile services are also integrated with push notifications. Okay, so in this regard, you have two options. You can just send notification to specific devices using the channel or the channel URI of that specific mobile device. On iOS it's called, in another way it's called, I don't remember, token, registration token or something like that, okay? But it's the same concept. Or you can now also leverage the so-called notification apps. Any of you is aware of notification apps? No. So notification apps work this way. Let's say that you want to create an app. I'll show you a little demo, okay, to give you an idea. But anyway, if you want to make a server application that is able to send notifications to a lot of different kinds of mobile devices, so iOS, Android, Windows Phone, Windows Store apps, okay? All of these classes of applications, they rely on a different push notification service. Apple has its own Apple push notification service. Google has the Google Cloud messaging service. For Windows Phone and Windows Store apps, we have two different push notification services. So your application would end up to communicate with all of these push notifications separately to send, you know, notification all at once using a broadcast mechanism to different classes of applications. So the objective of the push notification, sorry, of the notification app, as the name suggests, is you configure the notification app on the management portal on Windows Azure. You configure the credentials that are necessary to the notification app to talk with the individual push notification services, and your application only talks and send messages to the notification app. It's responsibility of the notification app to send notification to all of the other push notification services, Google, Apple, Windows Phone, Windows Store apps, okay? So going forward, now let's I'll show you how to create a mobile service. The only thing you need to interact with a mobile service are the REST API that you see on the slide. So basically, there are five operations. One is the login, if you want to make an application that requires the users to authenticate. And again, you don't need to create your own authentication mechanism. You can rely on Facebook, Twitter, Live ID, and Google. And the four crude operations, so query, insert, update, and delete. OK, so let me show you very quickly how you can create a mobile service. So you can go on the management portal, you click mobile services. As you can see, I have a bunch of mobile services. Let's create a new one. We give a name, like, I don't know, biztalk innovation, it's too long, let's say, I don't know, Hugo. Okay, you can create a database or select an existing one. Let's say I use an existing, let's create a new one, okay? No, Hugo is not, I don't like it. My name, Paolo. Or better, the name of my rabbit, Piccolo Leo. Okay, so I create a new database. On my account, I select the, okay, my region. Free database already exists on Palo Azure account, I know, so what? Let's say North Europe. Okay, let's use, I don't go through the entire, so I'm not going to create a new one. I just created a million. So as you can see, in the next, you can specify the database name, the location, the login name, and the username and password to log into your SQL Azure database, okay? Now, instead of clicking complete, I close and I show you a very simple one, okay? So this is what you get when you create a very simple mobile service. So on the dashboard, you can see information like the URL of the service. What does it create for you? It creates, as I said, a connecting database. So you can go here and create tables, for example. So you don't need to access, you know, the SQL Azure database through its interface. Okay, you can do this here. And the important thing is that here you can specify permissions. So you can say that everyone can access, for can insert, update, delete, or so. You have different permissions for each operations. Okay, so you can say everyone can read, but only, I don't know, that users with an application key or authenticated user can insert information, for example. As you can see, there are four different levels. I'm not going too much into detail. The first one is everyone. The second one is the application key. Every mobile application, mobile service has an application key. This is not a security mechanism. It's just a way to identify that application, okay? Because I'm saying that because when you are specifying that the application needs the application key is part of the mobile app. So everybody could go and, you know, use a disassembler to look at the application key. So it's not an authentication mechanism. If you want to protect your application, you have to use to integrate your application with existing identity providers and specify here only authenticated users, okay? Now, let's look at an existing so first of all, let me show you how you can interact with this application in this case, and we'll see more going forward. So in this case, I have a table. Okay, I have a table with two items. You see, checking my flight. This is the quick start tutorial. So every time you create a mobile service, you have the options on to go here, as you can see, and create the to-do item quick start application. Basically, this creates an application where you can create, you know, specify to-do items, the things you have to do, okay? So a to-do list. So this creates for you a table on SQL Azure, and also provides the client code, okay? So for what regards the client code, as you can see, the tutorial provides samples for the Windows Store app, Windows Phone 8, iOS, Android, and HTML5. Okay, so during this presentation, I'll show you example of Windows Store, Windows Phone 8, and HTML5. Okay, so and that's what you will find on my personal blog or MSDN Code Gallery. Anyway, so you have two options here. So when you create a table, okay, apart from data, you also have scripts. So you can think at scripts like, I don't know, the store procedure on a database. So as you can imagine, you can customize what happens every time a client application invokes a specific operation. So select, insert, delete, and update. For example, if you call an insert in insert operation, you can do things like validate data, enrich the data. You can send notifications. You will see this during the demo. Okay, so you can do a lot of things. So in this case, is pretty straightforward. Well, we'll look at samples where these scripts are doing a lot of stuff. But in June we also added the possibility to create APIs, custom APIs. That what does it mean? That it means that you can create scripts, okay, that define your own services without any table behind. Okay, so you don't have to rely on the scripts for insert, delete, update, and insert, delete, update, and select. Okay, so you can create whatever you want. So for example, if you want to invoke a line of business application, as we'll see in the rest of the presentation, you are probably going to use the custom API. So you can define any service you want, okay? Okay, the only point here is that at the moment, you can write scripts only using, you can use only, so behind the scene, these services are running on Node.js, okay? So why Microsoft took this decision instead of, I don't know, support C# at this level? Because most of the developers working in the mobile sector are working with JavaScript, jQuery, Node.js, and so forth, okay? In the future, I'm not going to make any commitment. Let's say there is a high chance that you will be able to make this script in C#, okay? I'm not authorized to say anything, but anyway. Let's say there is a high chance, okay. And so there are a lot of other functionalities I'm not going through because I don't have time. So for example, you can also create, you have a scheduler at your disposal, so you can create, for example, schedules, so you can specify a script that runs periodically. I have samples. If you want, you can write me after the session. I can send it to you, but I don't have time to show you. So, for example, if you want to make a sort of marketing campaign, so you want to schedule sending emails through a service provided by third parties that is called SendGrid. SendGrid provides email services. Or, for example, if you want to run a backup of your SQL Azure database, for example, I have a sample in this sense, and so forth. Or, for example, let's say you have a worker role running in a cloud service on your Azure subscription, and you want to trigger an operation every 15 minutes. You can just send a message to a service bus queue and have the worker role to pick up the message and start doing something, okay? Talking of the identity, so let's take an existing sample. As you can see here on the identity tab, I have Microsoft account settings, Facebook, Twitter, and Google. Okay, so you should go on the page of, for example, for Facebook. Let me see if I can show it to you. So for example, just to give you an idea, if I go and mobile services, Twitter, my application on Twitter. So you have to create, for example, let's take Twitter, okay? You have to create an account on the developer portal. So, hopefully this is going to work. So basically, you have to create one or multiple applications. So for example, in this case, I created two. And you can go here and copy the credential. Cut and paste the credentials. I don't remember which one. Ah, these two ones. Access token and access token secret. Okay. You copy and paste this information in here. And you are done. So your application is authorized, you know, to rely on Twitter authentication. Okay. If you want to see how it works, I can show you a quick demo. So, for example, this is an extended version of the to-do item demo with a different interface. But anyway, so if I log out, as you can see, I can log in with different accounts. So for example, I can log in with my Twitter. And as you can see, this starts an OAuth authentication scheme. So as you can see, it's redirecting. And now I'm logged with Twitter instead of the Microsoft account. Okay, so everything works. You know, you don't have to do anything. Just a line of code in the client code is just login. Okay. Okay, so very quickly, I just want to show you how easy it is to work with mobile services. So indeed, we provide an SDK for Windows Phone, Windows Store apps, iOS, and Android. So we provide classes that you can use as a proxy object to communicate with mobile services, okay? But in any case, the only thing you need is HTTP. It's really, really simple. I can work with mobile services just using Fiddler. How many of you know what is Fiddler? Is that, okay, that guy. Okay, here we go. Now, Fiddler is a tool that can be used to send HTTP requests using different methods. So get, post, patch, delete, whatever, okay? So if you want to test a mobile service, that's the only thing you need. You don't even need to make a client application, okay? And indeed, when I'm doing a mobile service, I don't spend time making the client application. That's the final part. I can just use Fiddler, okay? Let me show you an example. So if I go to the portal, let's get Planko, which is really, really simple. It has just one table, the to-do item table. I go on the dashboard. You see the URL, okay, of the service. So I can just go here and let me copy and paste because I don't want to spend too much time. So I can go here and say, let me show you if I can increase, here we go. So this is the URL of the mobile service. Then there is tables and the name of the table, to-do item, okay? So in this case, I can just select the get method, okay, and click the execute. I will get a 401 error that says that is unauthorized, okay? Just because I set as a permission that I at least require the application key. So I need to go on the portal and copy the key from here, application key, okay? So I copy the key, and let me say I create this header. This is an HTTP header, xzumo application. Zumo is the code name of mobile services, okay? So I can go here, cut and paste, execute. Here we go. So I retrieve the data in JSON format, okay? So I can also look at, you know, the, yes, in JSON format. Now, let's try to create a new item. So this time I need to select the post method. Let me create, I just want to cut and paste so I don't spend too much editing. So I create a new item that says, I don't know, no, go to Las Vegas, no, let's go to my city, Pisa. Okay, complete false, okay. So I click execute. Here we go, so we had 201, and in fact, if we come back on the port and we go to the data, and we look at, we should have the new, here we go, the new record, okay. Now let's delete the record. It's very easy. I just need to specify the ID of the record. So the ID is 13. I just go here, I specify 13, and I choose delete. Okay. I click, now I refresh, and the item should be gone. Okay, so it's very, very easy, okay. Now, let's look at something more appealing and complex. Okay, we start from zero to, I don't know, 1 million, okay, probably on this picture. So this is the first scenario. I don't want to spend too much time on explaining the various steps. Just want to explain the scenario. So let's say you have an HTML5 application or a Windows Phone application, Windows Store app, and you want to access the data that are on your corporate network. In this case, it's a database on my laptop. How can you do that? You can rely on mobile services to create the layer of RESTful services. But in this case, I'm not interested to get data from SQL Azure. I want rather to get data from the corporate database, okay? So in this case, I need to expose this data. So that's what I do. On my machine, I have a WCF service running on IIS. And this WCF service, from the one end, expose an endpoint on the service bus namespace, as you can see. And on the other end, it communicates with the local database, okay? Now, when a WCF service uses the service bus relay service to expose an endpoint on the service bus, you have two options. You can make this endpoint callable by everyone. That means the client application doesn't require to authenticate. But of course, this is not the case. You don't want that endpoint to be called by everybody, okay? So in this case, you are going to protect that endpoint. How you can you protect that endpoint? You can use the access control service, okay? So as you can see on this slide, the mobile service receives requests from the client applications. It acquires a token to talk to the service bus from ACS, and then it creates a SOAP envelope and sends this envelope to the WCF service. Okay, so let me show you the demo. So in this case, I have a database on my machine called ProductDB with a single table. So let's select top. Okay, here we go. Then I have a WCF service on IIS, which is called SOAP products. If we look at, I don't know, let's see the web.config. So browse. Oh, let me open the solution. It's much better. So
if I go and open the solution, open project, mobile services, service bus relay, and SOAP. As you will see, the WCF service expose, so let me see, program app.config.
Okay, for in this case it's running on a console app just for demo purposes. Of course, in a production environment it would run on IIS. As you can see, it exposes, let me increase the font size, three different endpoints. One is basically is using HTTP relay binding, the other one is basic HTTP relay binding, and the final one is using the web HTTP relay binding. So in particular, this endpoint is a RESTful endpoint, okay, that we'll use in the next demo, okay? If we look at the code of the mobile service, which is probably more interesting, so you can see some real code, we switch to the API section. These are custom APIs, so custom scripts. Let's get the SOAP version, so it's products. I'm not going through all the details at the moment, okay, but basically I have, first of all, for those of you that are, you know, that knows Node.js and JavaScript, you have to export the functions, so get, post, patch, put. Basically you define what happens when one of these HTTP methods is invoked. As you can see, I always invoke this get ACS token because I invoke ACS under the cover. I need to specify the service bus namespace used to authenticate, to create the token that is used to communicate with the service bus. And then going forward, I have different methods for the different functions, so get, delete, create, and so forth. For each of them, as you can see, I create a SOAP envelope, and I have to specify the token in the relay access token header in the SOAP envelope. As you will see in the REST version of the demo, this is much easier, because when invoking a RESTful endpoint exposed by a WCF service, the only thing you have to specify, first of all, you don't have to create a SOAP envelope. It's a RESTful service, so you are using JSON. And the second thing, you specify the authentication token in the authorization HTTP header, okay? So here you create the headers, you have to specify the SOAP action, the content type text XML, a bunch of other things. You make a call, and going forward, when I receive a response back from the service, is in XML. But the mobile service communicates with my client application using JSON. So I need to turn XML into JSON. So I'm using a module provided by Node.js called XML to JS to make the magic. But then I also have to make some more processing to transform the XML into JSON. And I return, in this case, the products in JSON format to the client application, okay? Again, I don't ask you to understand all the details. If you want, you can go and look at the whole story on my blog, okay? With all the references to articles to go even deeper for what regards Node.js and mobile services. So, in this, as you can see, this is the same pattern is used by all over the other functions. So, let me use these a mobile application, okay? So, or I can also use, let's start with HTML5. So this is the SOAP version, yes. So I refresh. When I refresh, I'm invoking the mobile service, and the mobile service is invoking let me show you this. It's invoking this guy. Okay, so as you can see, I invoke get products. Now let's try, so this is The WCF service is running within the, this console application, okay, for demo purpose, so you can see what's going on. So let's try to, so let's delete, for example, this item. We reduce the size of this guy so you can see. So I delete this guy. So I should see a delete product, you see. Or, for example, let me add a new one, big toe. It's a toys. So toys category 20. So I, now you will see, okay, here we go. Here we go. So you also see a notification because under the cover, also on the mobile application, because under the cover I'm using notification apps, okay? So I just use, I'm using notification apps in the code so that whenever I add a new product, I also want to send a notification to everybody, hey, a new item is available in the store, okay? Something like that. Let me show you how easy it is using notification apps. So first of all, if you want to create a notification app, you have two choices. You can go on the portal and select your service bus namespace, like in this case, and switch to the notification apps. And you can create a new one. As you can see, I have one here. And again, under the configure section, you have to specify the credentials. Like in the for the authentication, you have to specify credentials to communicate with the underlying push notification services, Apple, Google, Microsoft, okay? Or you can also do this with my wonderful tool, the Service Bus Explorer, so because in the recent version that I published 10 days ago, I added support for notification apps. You can do more, you can also use my tool to see, for example, not just for to create or manage notification apps, but you can also look at the registrations. So whenever, let me explain this. If you want to use notification apps to notify a mobile app, you need to use the API on that mobile app. So that it's responsibility of the mobile application to do the following steps. It needs to register with the push notification service. Let's say it's a Windows Phone application, it needs to register to the Windows Phone notification service. When it acquires a channel URI, okay, a URL basically, it needs to invoke a method exposed by the client API for notification apps to say, hey, if you want to send me notifications, this is my URL. And you can do more than that. The client application can also say, I want to be notified only when the tag is equal to, belongs to this set of tags. So let's say you are a Milan fan, Juventus fan, Inter fan. Inter fan, it's very hard to be an Inter fan. Anyway, okay, but any Inter fans here? No? Okay, fortunately. Okay, thank you. So so you can just send notifications and specify, okay, I just want to be notified in when you send out messages for with this tag. Okay, same story for a stock market. I just want to have to be notified for when something happens for the stocks I have in my portfolio. Okay, something like that. And you have two options. When you send notifications, you can send template notifications that can be sent to all of the devices in parallel. And then it's up to the device to decide how to show the notification. For example, it could be, when a client device registers, it can decide, oh, I want to register this template. And in case of a Windows mobile application, is a live tile or a toast notification, okay? For example, let me show you registrations for this notification app. If we go here in my tool and I bring one of these registrations, I can go here and see the template. And as you can see, this is a toast notification. So my mobile app running on Windows Phone. On Windows Phone said, okay, I want to be notified. I will use this template, and you I just want to be notified when the tag is equal to product service, okay? So, for example, I can use also my tool to send notifications. So it's also a test environment. So I can say here, let me show you this. Hopefully it's going to work. So I say, products, Maserati GLB is now available. Okay, if you have money for that. Okay, so if I send, I should hopefully receive, here we go, a notification. Here we go. Okay, so pretty straightforward. If you want to see what it requires on a mobile service level, let me show you this. If I go here, this is all you need. So you have to create, you have to use a module in Node.js which is called Azure. The Azure module, it's a module, think at modules like libraries, okay, on Microsoft platform, and they provide access to various functionalities. In this case, they provide, the Azure module provides access to all the services provided by Azure. So service bus, notification apps, stable storage, blob storage, and so forth, okay? So in this case, I just create, as you can see, notification app service. I have to specify the name and the connection string. You can get this information from the portal. And the only thing I need is to create a payload. In this case, it's the notification. In this case, it's in JSON and a tag, okay? And then I can just use the send method. That's it, okay? So the notification apps also provides the ability to send native notifications. Native notification means that they are targeted to a specific platform. So you can just send notifications to a Windows phone, iOS, and so forth. And in that case, it's the sending application that decides the template, okay, for the receiver. Okay, let's get back to the slides. I have a lot of, this is just the first demo, so I don't really think I will have time to show all of them, but I just want to give you an idea. Okay, so let me skip the details, also because we have seen some of them. This is a variation of the previous application, of the previous demo. So in this case, the WCF service exposes a RESTful service using the web HTTP relay binding. So the only difference with the previous sample is that my custom API, my mobile service, doesn't require to create a SOAP envelope. It can just talk. It doesn't need also to act as a bridge between XML, or if you prefer, SOAP and JSON. Okay, it can just talk JSON with both the client and the underlying service. Okay, so very quickly, if we look at the code, for example, of the add product, as you can see, there is no SOAP envelope. I have to specify the token in the authorization header. Content type is application JSON. And then I'm using the request module, the HTTPS module to make a request against the service. When I get back the results, I can just send it back to the client application. I just parse the string, the body, into JSON. That's it, okay? So I'm not going to show you this, but yeah, I mean, just to give an idea, it's this is the REST version, but it has the same interface, okay? So I can go here and delete this guy, for example. And in this case, I'm passing by the other version of the solution. Let's move on. This is probably the most interesting one for you. In Steve's presentation before, you have seen the concept of bridge, okay? So the bridge is like, I don't know, for those of you using the ESB toolkit, you can think at the message itinerary like an itinerary in the ESB toolkit. Not so complex, okay? It doesn't provide any orchestration functionality at the moment, just the messaging part, okay? So basically, you can use a bridge. Your bridge provides, you know, functionalities that you can find in Biztalk Server in the pipelines. So you can do things like message enrichments, message parsing, message transformation. You can promote properties that then you use in the routing table within your bridge to decide the destination. Okay, and that's what this demo actually does. Because as you will see, this is just a calculator. Of course, you need all the entire solution to make 2 + 2, because of course you lost the ability to make calculations. And what the solution does is, you have an HTML5 or a Windows Store app. I don't have time to show you the Windows Store app. This invokes a mobile service. Again, the service is protected with ACS. So, if you want to communicate with Biztalk Service, you have to acquire an authentication token. This is mandatory. Okay, so the mobile service, Biztalk Services at the moment are not exposed as real services. Let me explain what does it mean. It means that you don't make a real WCF service. A call or a SOAP call. You create an envelope and you send the envelope using a POST. Okay, so it's not really a web service call. We already said to the product group that they should expose Biztalk Services as a RESTful service. Okay, that's the expectation of the market, let's say. So they will probably work on that. At the moment, the only way to send messages is using SOAP and a POST method. So then we have the bridge. We'll look at the bridge. But as you can see, even if it's very small, the bridge transformed the incoming message from the format used by the mobile service into the format expected by the underlying service. Okay, and also makes something interesting. Promotes one of the elements in the payload called location that I can set using the interface. And I can decide to send this operation to the Europe or US instances of the same service. Okay, so basically, you do what you do in Biztalk when you promote a property, and then you decide where to send the message. Okay, based on a subscription. And the communication between the Biztalk service and the calculator is made using the service bus relay service. Now, in the original demo, I had two console applications. I said, okay, let's make this even more complex. So in the demo, you are going to see, indeed, the two services, they are receive locations running on Biztalk Server. So we have, in this case, mobile services, ACS, Biztalk Services, service bus, and Biztalk Server. Okay, so let me show you this very quickly. So at the Biztalk Server level, I have this receive location, as you can see, is using the new WCF NAT TCP relay to expose this endpoint. You can see Paolo Salvatore service bus, windows.net, Europe calculator NAT TCP. To make sure that everything is working fine, you can go on the management portal and you can access your service bus and switch to the relays tabs to make sure that the endpoint is indeed available. Okay, it's there, it can be called, it can be invoked. As you can see, I have many. You can also eventually use my tool if you like, if you want to send messages to the endpoints. Okay, so you can specify the payload and in the sender how many messages you want to send, how many clients you want to simulate, the binding to use, and blah blah blah. Okay. Now, if I go on the interface, so let's look at the HTML5 interface because we don't have time to look at another one. So I go here, I define 10 plus 20, for example, and another operation, 21, I don't know, plus 19, whatever. Okay. Now when I click the send button, if everything works as expected, yes. Let me see, okay, here we go. I also have debug view. So as you can see,
Let's do it this again so we can see live. So let's resend the same operation. I don't care. Here we go. So what you can see on debug view is a trace produced by an orchestration. Okay. So the stack is the HTML5 application uses the jQuery. Okay, behind the scene. So let me show you the code very quickly. I don't want to provide too many details, but I realized I didn't show you what it required on the client side. So on the client side, you can see this is the HTML version. You have this object called mobile service client, where you have to specify the URL of the mobile service plus the infamous application key. And then you can use, for example, different methods. So in this case, since I'm invoking custom APIs, I use the invoke API. And then I have to specify things like the name of the API that I want to invoke and the method that I want to use. Or, for example, if I'm adding a new product, for example, I have to specify as a method post. And I have to specify the product in the body of the outgoing message. Okay. So for those of you that are using jQuery, think about mobile service like the Ajax or GetJSON, for example. Okay, it's the same API. Same story for the Windows Phone and Windows Store app. Let me say something interesting. The library for mobile client for Windows Store apps and Windows Phone is portable. That means that it's exactly the same library. Then there are specific libraries for each platform. But this means that when you code against the mobile service client, it's exactly the same code wherever you work for, whenever you are building a Windows Phone app or a Windows Store app, okay? So as you can see, the only thing you need to do is to create the mobile service client, again, specify the application URL and the key, and then if we switch to the code, for example, let's see the code to get all the products, okay? You have seen the mobile app, this one, okay? This one. The only thing you need to do in this case is invoke the API, and specify the get method, period. And you get results, and you can use an observable collection to link these to local controls. Okay, very quickly, let's see the other demos. Just 5 minutes, so 5 minutes left. So this is yet another demo. I'm not going to explain the code, just the context. This is an extended version of to-do item application. The interesting thing in this case is that, this is yet the product service application, sorry. But it's in a different flavors. So in this case, to access the underlying database, I'm using what Steve's showed in one of his demos. So basically, I'm using the so-called biztalk adapter service. Now, in order to use the biztalk adapter service in Visual Studio, you have to go here, biztalk adapter service. You can expand, and you see you have a bunch of adapters that you can use. Okay, these are exactly the same adapters of the biztalk adapter pack. In case of SQL, as you can see, I created this service. Okay, there is a wizard. You can see the single pages on my blog. So at the very end, what this produces, it creates this website on IIS. This is just a WCF service. And in fact, in my demo, I'm invoking that service from a bridge. But indeed, you could invoke that service even without a bridge directly. It's a relay service, OK? So let me show you the bridge, because so far we didn't see any bridge. So let me find the right solution, this one. Here we go. So we have here an XML request reply bridge. This is a two-way bridge. I have message types on the for request messages on one end and the response messages on the other end. Again, I have get, delete, update, and so forth. On the enrich, I promote one of the properties based on the SOAP action of the incoming message. Here I have transformation. I have maps because I'm mapping the format sent by the mobile service into the format expected by the SQL adapter in this case. Okay. And the same on the way back. Now, if we switch to the itinerary, you can see they have my bridge and the product DB. That is, this represents the biztalk adapter service running on my machine. I have four different routes because every route is for a different operation. So as you can see here, I have in the filter condition, it says, take this route only if the request action, that is a promoted property, okay, so I read the action of the incoming request and I promote with the name a request action. If it's equal to add product, take this route, okay? And if you go to the route action, I specify the SOAP action of the outgoing message in this case. And I'm following the rules of the SQL adapter. So I said table op, insert DBO, and the name of the table on the database, okay? So, having said that, very quickly, let's reuse this application. So if I don't know, refresh. Okay, I'm retrieving the products through the adapter, or I can add a new one. So for example, I don't know, biztalk categories. I don't know. Server products. I don't know the price. You will be surprised. I have no idea of the price. Okay. I don't deal with licensing stuff. Okay. So as you can see, it was added. Everybody knows now, thanks to the notification app. And just to confirm, I can go here and rerun the query. So yeah, execute and we have biztalk. Okay. So final 1 minute. I'm skipping the last one, but I want you to see this one. So this is a demo that I'm going to publish in the coming days. It's working on my machine, but the article is not out yet. The question is, I made a session at TechReady in June, and a guy from, you know, always from the last row. If somebody has something to say, he's always from the last row, okay? And this guy came out and said, oh, but I don't need to use mobile service. I can create my own web application running or in a web role or in a website, and I can do the same thing, basically, okay? So I said, okay, this time for the next TechReady, I don't go there unprepared, okay? Let me do the same thing using a website. So as you can see, websites on Windows Azure are a way to publish and host your ASP.NET applications, web API services, and so forth in a very easy way without creating web roles and so forth. You can just download the publishing settings. You go on the project. You specify the publishing settings. You say publish, and in 1 minute you can publish your ASP.NET application on Azure. So what this demo does is replace the mobile service with an ASP.NET MVC4 application. So the interface is yet the HTML, the infamous HTML5 plus JavaScript, but in this case the application instead. All of the client application, instead of invoking mobile services, they invoke a layer of RESTful services implemented with ASP.NET Web API. Okay, so this is nothing really to show apart from because the interface is exactly the same. When I click biztalk services, I'm saying go and retrieve products from biztalk using the same
approach that we have seen before, Biztalk adapter service and the SQL adapter, okay? So this is just to say you don't necessarily need mobile services, okay? So for example, if you, at the moment, again, we don't provide the ability to create scripts in C Sharp, you don't feel comfortable with writing JavaScript, you want to use ASP.NET Web API, okay, you can do the same kind of solution, just replace mobile service with a website. Okay, so let's conclude. This is just another demo, but I'm not going through. Basically, from a mobile service, you can also send messages through the service bus. So in this demo, I was just invoking Biztalk to get the address of a user. And at the very end of the transaction, I was sending a message to a queue to say, hey, there is another user, okay, to Biztalk server, okay? I was using the service bus, a service bus queue. So related contents, again, you can go and read all the story from my articles. You can just go on MSDN code gallery, or you can go on my personal blog. Okay, my personal blog is this one. Blah, blah, blah. My blog. Basically, is MSDN, blah, 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 Paulos, my alias. Okay. So, to conclude, let me say one thing and I'm done. It's not easy to go and convince customers to, you know, to move their applications to the cloud. If you go there and say, okay, move the entire infrastructure so you have, they say, okay, that's the door, okay, we have a nice day, okay. But if you start doing applications like these, they are not tier one application, you know, they are not mission critical application, they start to get comfortable with this stuff. Trust me, because I see this every time, every day, okay? So I think this is a good approach, also because they feel comfortable, because they keep their assets, their data, whatever, at home. You're not asking them to move their databases to the cloud, okay? Not all of them, okay? So this is, I think, an important class that can help you to start doing something in the cloud with your customers. And I'm done. Okay, questions? Shocked?
Any questions?